Okay. I'd like to call the Town of Niskiuna Conservation Advisory Council to order. This is the November 15th, 2022 meeting. We'll start the meeting by taking roll.
So I have Chelsea Radner, Nikki Vizolid, I'm sorry, Ashok Ramasubramanian, Simran Uterkar, and Dart Strayer. Ellen Daviero is going to join us by phone as soon as it is safe for her to pull over and join.
Okay, great. So we have 2 minutes to approve. So why don't we start with the August 3rd, 2022. I would take a motion to approve it or any changes that people wanted to make on that. So are you motioning we adopt?
Yes.
Okay. I will second it. Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, the motion carries. Okay, September 7th, we have those minutes. I actually wasn't at that meeting, I was out of town, so. Okay. Okay, you want a second? Okay, motion seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, we have privilege of the floor, but are all you guys related to the development? Okay. All right, seeing no one wanting to speak at the privilege of the floor, we'll move on unless someone has emailed you and wants to speak through Skype.
I just checked. I don't have any virtual requests.
Okay. Okay, great. So we'll move on. EAF 2022-07, 2721 Balltown Road, and it is a project that involves the development of a two multifamily dwellings. If you would like to state your name and your association with the project, and then we can sort of, you can make a presentation.
Sure.
Yep.
My name's Rob Stout. I'm the project attorney on this project with Whiteman, Osterman, and Hannah.
Okay.
So this project relates to 2721 Balltown. Approximately 2 years ago, our client obtained a use variance to convert an existing structure that had three apartments and an animal hospital in it into a multifamily project or multifamily building with six apartment units in it. Now what he's looking to do is reflected on this plan, although this plan is subject to change as we go through the process with the planning board, is to construct two additional apartment buildings on site, both containing six units for an extra 12 units, total of 18 when the project is complete. Throughout the planning board consultation review process, we've agreed to do certain things that will hopefully increase the buffer as between the project site and those homes to the south. Just last night, our client agreed to essentially flip the residential building to the south with the proposed accessory garage located along the northern property line, which will allow that residential structure to be tucked closer to the 25-foot side yard setback to the north, thereby preserving a greater degree of tree line to the south of the property. Mm-hmm. There is a pond and some potential wetlands to the rear of the property, which is why we're not developing anything to the rear. We've been discussing with Laura, working with our engineer to make sure a delineation is done such that we maintain the project not only out of the wetlands, but out of any buffer area that would be associated with that as well. So the relief requested is a use variance, because the use variance that was granted in 2020 only contemplated the existing structure to the front of the property. Mm-hmm. As well as area variances. One area variance would allow more than one principal building mm-hmm. on the lot, because the definition of lot only allows for one principal building. The other area variance relates to the side yard setback. this plan abides by the underlying 25-foot side yard setback in the RP district. The issue with that, though, is that because this is a multifamily dwelling, there are supplemental regulations that require a 40-foot side yard setback for multifamilies. That said, our application materials to the ZBA point out that if we were to fully develop this lot under the supplementary regulations at a rate of 10 units per acre, which is what is allowed, that would yield 33 total units. So we're only proposing to yield 18 total units. Likewise, three stories are permitted. We're only proposing two stories mm-hmm. for the new structures. And also coverage ratio of 30% buildings and structures is allowed for multifamily structures. We're proposing to abide by the underlying 20% coverage ratio for the RP zoning district in which the property sits.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an overview. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to address them.
I have a couple. The buildings you propose, what is their configuration? What is the developer planning on having them look like? Do you have any elevations or anything?
We don't have any elevations. The architecture would be consistent with the renovations to the building that sits along the existing building. As we've discussed with the planning board and with Laura, because the use variance issue is a threshold issue.
Mm-hmm.
Essentially, if we don't get it from the ZBA, then the project can't go anywhere. We were waiting till we get to the point of site plan review before the planning board before we do the full engineering package that would be required for site plan approval.
Okay, so you haven't done any of the engineering on this? This is just
no, beyond this layout plan, this is all we have for the purposes of obtaining the use and area mm-hmm. variances. But we understand a site plan amendment would require a much more detailed application.
Mm-hmm. And does the applicant, can he show that he has a hardship here?
Yes, actually, in the ZBA application that we submitted today, we've actually pointed to some case law that governs modifications of previously issued use variances. And those cases are clear that if you're modifying a previously issued use variance, you don't have to go through the four-step hardship test in order to obtain that modification. That said, we've also included in the application materials an analysis under those four factors should the ZBA not accept that argument. The chief reason for the hardship, for needing to expand this use, is that when the building along the road was previously renovated, there were some substantial construction costs that were unanticipated at the time that the previous use variance was requested.
Mm-hmm.
The sewer line was uncovered and it was determined to be in a condition that required replacement. Same with the water line on the property, and there were some pretty substantial cost increases associated with the construction given the supply chain delays and other inflationary pressures on the project over the course of the last 2 years. The net of that was that the project development costs were about $140,000 in excess of what was anticipated at the time the initial use variance was required, and we cite those factors as weighing on the existing hardship.
Sorry, Chairman, the live stream sound is not working again. But we're recording two backups, so.
Okay.
And my client, Alex Ritmo, is here as well, if you have any questions for him.
Have the current apartments, they're all rented?
They are, yes.
Yeah. And they've been an apartment complex for how long?
Just over, I think it's almost 2 years now.
2 years. You said that you didn't have the wetlands delineated. Do you anticipate the wetlands impacting that current configuration at all?
We spoke about it at last night's meeting. As of now, we're unsure. sure, but I have hired a I can't pronounce the word that well, but my engineer hired somebody to delineate all of it for me. So I should have that in a week or two.
Mm-hmm. And approximately, I drove by the site today, so approximately how much acreage of trees are you going to take down if this project went forward?
So everything is under an acre of disturbance. That's the whole, so that's all three buildings plus the garage. Including existing.
So those buildings themselves are going to show up in the primarily the open space that's there right now?
Yeah, that's our goal, is to keep it in the openness, but that's
where the existing tree
okay,
is.
Yeah.
Regarding the remaining open space that is left, if the project were to go ahead, does the applicant have any support for delineating that as forever wild, which is a category,
like,
you know,
the trees in the back and stuff?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not against it, but if we can leave it as is for now, that'd be better.
It does improve long-term home values to have some woodsy part next to it, and has positive health outcomes as well.
Yep.
And as such, as the delineations of the CAC, the Conservation Advisory Council, is concerned, such a move would be positively considered.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the most that I would ever do back there if the project was, if it did go through, is just kind of have a little walking area around the pond.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I would do.
Perhaps a condition would be that if the approvals are granted, then no additional residential structures could be erected there, which would still allow for the recreational uses that the clients
I was proposing something a little bit more than that, to set aside as forever wild, which would be a designation saying that you leave it be. Like putting a walking path through it would be fine, but clearing some trees and putting a playground in there would not be fine. That was my the town of Niskayuna is also separately in the process of adopting a comprehensive plan for the next 10 years, and we've been talking to residents, and preservation of green space in its undisturbed form is something that residents keep telling us over and over again in terms of where they want the town to move forward in the next 10 years. You know, but I want to be absolutely clear, it's the applicant's land, it's not our land. I'm just saying, from a conservation perspective, as far as this committee is concerned, such a move would be favorably looked upon. Okay. Mm-hmm. I also, do you, the ecological consultant that the applicant's engineer has hired, you know, you mentioned that like a full site plan stuff is all going on. So what we would like to see is, like, you know, what are the ecological features of the land that could be potentially undisturbed? We'd like to see like some basic description of that. I guess what I'm trying to say in many words is that, like, as Niskayuna moves forward, we are trying to find a balance between the needs of development and housing and tax base and all that. Also, the residents' desire to preserve green space as much as possible. And there's no reason to suspect that we can't come to a position where with some detailed back and forth, everyone can't be reasonably satisfied. Well, you know, again, if I may say so, to put that in writing and set it as forever wild would be, indication of a commitment from the applicant's part towards future conservation desires of the town.
I guess I have a question relating to the placement. I mean, this parcel is an R1 or RP zone. It's RP zone. It's surrounded by single family homes. Why not develop it as single family homes? I mean, I think part of this particular project was there was an existing building, there were two non-conforming uses, and I know that this board, and I know, other boards were looking at this as we were taking two non-conforming uses and making them one non-conforming uses, and the other part of the project was to remove all the other buildings from the property, and that went into this committee's recommendations. So the question I have is, seems like we're putting those buildings back on this property, so wouldn't single-family homes be more appropriate here?
So when I did this project, DOT made me eliminate the other egress because the driveway used to be a horseshoe, if you remember.
Yeah, I remember that, yep. Mm-hmm.
So they don't want any more egress locations. So basically, if I did do single families, their driveway would essentially have to go through an apartment building's mm-hmm. parking lot now. Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
So yeah, basically, I would have to build the houses, and I guess this is my opinion, but you'd have to sell them for less because who, when they're coming home from work, wants to drive through an apartment complex with two houses located in the back? Plus, it's just not really going to fit with the rest of what's going on there now.
It'd essentially be two, at most probably flag lots that you would have to. Oh,
yeah.
I'm so sorry. It would essentially be creating one or maybe two flag lots that would have very narrow access points.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
To single-family dwellings located in the rear of the property.
Chairman Stryer, sorry to go against your wishes. Personally, I am in favor of a multifamily dwelling because, among other things, Niskayuna has a racial equity task force which wants to bring in people from a diverse economic background into Niskayuna. A single-family home essentially severely restricts the type of people who can purchase that. So again, with apologies to Chairman Strayer, I'm in favor of the multi-unit dwelling. But I feel like I've been talking a lot, so I'll.
I was going to agree that I think a multifamily would be best in this situation. I really like the idea of, having more affordable housing available in Niskayuna. I think that this use of space would be nice as that. But just to clarify, you were saying before, so the garage and the residential building would be flipped, correct?
Yes. Yeah.
I'm just trying to envision that.
So
this would be up here.
Okay.
Well, yeah, so what came up at the planning board was the proposed limits of clearing, which are kind of the black here.
Oh, no.
Sorry. I need a new computer. This black line, is the proposed limits of clearing. This is the existing trees. And this is not constructible, right, because you wouldn't be able to leave the limits of clearing that close to the edge of the building. So the planning board was really concerned that essentially all of these trees would probably have to be removed to build the building that close to the lot line. So what they wanted to do is flip this building to this side, put the garage here, and then shift everything to the north. But that's subject to the wetlands delineation that he mentioned that he was working on. But I don't know if you flip it to the north why you couldn't have proposed patios. Like, I would like to see that people who rent the apartments, have space to be outside.
Yeah, and I think flipping it would probably allow us more to do that. And then the only other thing we talked about is we're going to push that the apartment building now to the 25-foot buffer as tight as we can, where there's a little gap right now.
And do some additional screening within the 25-foot buffer on the north that's currently not buffered.
So what is the price point of these apartments that you're...
Right now? So right now, they range anywhere from $1,250 to $1,750.
17?
And yeah.
The new apartments, what are you...
So my biggest apartment there is, it's 1,450 square feet, so it's pretty big. It's basically a house, and that's for $1,750. All the other ones are anywhere from 850 square feet to 1,000, and those are the ones that are renting from 1,250 to...
Mm-hmm. And the new units you're proposing, what is your price
point? I'm going to try to match them, because it seems like all apartments now are 2,300 or more if you got a garage or something. So I'm trying to, you know, make something reasonable but still nice.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Ritmer, what is preventing you from proposing three stories?
I personally just don't like the look of the three stories. It makes it look like a massive structure. And here, I don't think it would go well. Plus, it would raise the height of the building, so the people in that neighborhood would now be looking at a three-story building. The trees roughly right now are anywhere from 65 to 75 feet tall. So the buildings I'm proposing are going to be about 30 to 35, where if I add another story, now we're talking 8 to 9 feet. So you're getting closer to the top of the trees. And obviously in the winter, there's not as many branches towards the top, so.
There's also a standard paragraph that the CAC always attaches to all our recommendations, like we request new developments not to use lawn pesticides because they are pretty nasty. Again, note the word request. You know, it's mm-hmm. not binding in any way. Moving in the International COP27 summit is going on right now in Indonesia. People are talking about climate change and things like that. So, to the extent possible, we always encourage new developments to go with renewable sources, solar power to the extent possible, LED lightings, and so on. That's a standard paragraph that we always say, and use native species for landscaping and things like that.
Okay.
And I hope the applicant will be receptive to something like that.
Okay.
I have a question. Where does the R1 boundary, is there any R1 in this area, or?
Let me pull that up here.
Yeah. What's the neighboring district?
So I believe
these houses here, is that R2 or is that R1?
No, I believe they're actually in RP, but let me just, because the planning board, board asked that, and I thought they were in R3, but then I double checked. And so the Amador Homes development, Harmon Grove, which is directly behind
mm-hmm.
this, is zoned R3.
Zoned R3?
R3 is allowed to have single family residential, it's just high density.
Mm-hmm.
And then the development to the south, that's Schwaber Drive, is zoned RP. The single-family home to the north, all the way up until the property line with E1, is zoned RP as well. So it's all zoned.
It is RP, okay.
So it's all zoned RP along Balltown Road there. The RP really extends from the E1 driveway down to the backside of Riley Way, and then behind it is R3, and across the road is IR, which is the research and industrial.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, are there any other questions that we have for the developer?
Hi, this is Ellen. And I've been listening for a little bit. So I just want to, jump on with the as much, energy that we can save. I know that people have put, the solar panels on top of the parking spaces. So is that going to be a covered parking spaces that you're going to have, that garage?
Yes.
So, I mean, have you thought of putting solar energy on top of that?
I haven't looked into it, but I can look into it. I'm not opposed to it.
Okay. You know, I know that there is a, you know, there's already one in Rotterdam that, I mean, that's been there for a number of years. I know it's slipped. I don't know which way the sun goes or whatever, but that would be appreciated if you would look into it.
Okay.
And I would also say, you know, I reiterate that, you know, no pesticides, try to pick things that are, you know, that are landscaping, that are natural, you know, that sort of thing, you know, if this comes to fruition. And, yeah, I think that's it. Thank you.
The name of that development is Solara Apartment Buildings, and I have driven through there. It's really nice. They're just net zero energy, and it might actually help save you some.
Yeah, I'm from that area, so I'm familiar with that.
Yeah, the state will subsidize some of that for you often. Like, you put, it's a little bit extra money up front, but they'll give you the money up front, and then you save money over time because it's more energy efficient.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm just looking at the EAF, so though. I just wanted to mention the number 5A is the proposed action permitted under the zoning use regulations.
Mm-hmm.
Were you going to bring that up? I wanted you to
read it.
Take a look at that because it's not. I mean, that's why you're.
Yeah.
That was why you're denied, and you've checked mark yes there.
Right, and then that wasn't some measure intentional, because part of our argument is that the previously issued use variance makes this use, multifamily use, permitted. We understand that the building department disagrees with that perspective, which is why in our application, not only did we reassert that argument, but we also provided an analysis under the use variance criteria. So checking that box, yes, was consistent with our position that we think the previously issued use variance is sufficient to allow this use to be a permitted use in the zone.
We, though, at this meeting right now, we are not passing any judgment on the building itself. I mean, we were asked to look at this from the perspective of the ZBA to make a recommendation. So
understood.
I just want to make that clear.
Right, and I just want to make it clear that there was some thought behind that question, but I certainly understand
mm-hmm.
the different perspective that you have.
Yeah.
Okay, and then also consistent with the adopted comprehensive plan, I know this is the first time you guys are seeing that, but it might be worth it to just kind of page through the comprehensive plan and decide where you're landing on that, because that's going to be a question in the second part that we have to answer.
Yep. Yeah, I know that the comprehensive plan recommends that this retain a rural landscape, and that, you know, the current zoning exists in this area. So this would be not, the proposal here is not consistent with the vision of the 2013 plan.
Well, the current zoning allows for an office building or a medical office to be
I'm
placed
just,
there.
I'm just stating what it says
right.
in the plan.
Okay. And then another thing is just down the road from you guys at the Trinity Baptist Church, they did a wetland delineation, and then they had to submit with the seeker. Obviously, it went to the DEC, and they had to have a historic preservation. There was something
survey.
That triggered them to do a survey.
Like a phase 1A?
It was very mild, but you're not very far from them, so.
Right, and that one of the answers was triggered, yes, I think, too.
Yeah, and
mm-hmm.
that may be why that they had to do that, too, because I think the area is generally, if you pull up a DEC mapper, the
mm-hmm.
answer to the question is yes, which may be why it filled it out for you if you did it on the DEC mapper. But at least consistent with the last time, and I'll reach out to DEC, you might have to do the SHPO there.
Okay. We could talk to somebody and do like a records review of the site, if that's what the other site.
Yeah, I believe at the minimum they had to put it on the website and submit it for them to comment. You know how you can draw that little box on
mm-hmm.
the CRIS?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then two other things. which the Conservation Advisory Council and the Tree Council often overlap. Is the Tree Council just looked at this project very quickly on last Thursday and noted that, and I know Alex and I had talked about this before, that along Balltown Road, there was a large tree there prior to him owning it. I think right when you were purchasing it, a storm took it down or something. And it's very bare from the southern all the way up. Like, so they had requested a line of native trees along there. It's very bare. So, you know, probably the CAC would be in support of more trees being planted, not just for screening, also. And then the only other comment, which I brought up, I think, before, I'm not sure if you guys have heard it yet or not, but I can probably bring up a different screen so you can see this, but the back of the property essentially abuts back here where there's sand. This is where the town of Niskayuna has a stormwater detention pond, and if the use variance was approved at the zoning board, right now these apartments are very isolated and they don't really have anywhere to walk because it's pretty unsafe to walk Balltown Road in that area. And so I think before when we were looking at connections, the suggestion was to make a path from the apartment complex through the detention pond to the actual road so that if these guys ever wanted to walk, they could be connected to the single family homes who are going to be connected to the senior center at some point. So theoretically, anybody who lived in these apartments would be able to walk all the way over to like the football fields.
That was a question I had. Is there actual space to put a path back there, or is that developed all the way back there?
So I don't know that I can. I mean, I probably could, but
because on the west of that, doesn't the Amador parcel just back up on that?
Yeah, there's space.
There is space.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's kind of a long-term thing, but if you can make connections, you know, between neighborhoods and between apartment complexes to neighborhoods, that's always a better thing. There's nowhere else that anybody living there would ever be able to walk to.
Okay, if there's no other questions, thanks for...
Forgive my ignorance. What is the next step? Like, what happens, and what does the applicant do next? Like,
well, the applicant...
Like, when will we see, updates?
Well, what has to happen here is at our next meeting, we'll be asked to make a recommendation, which will be used for the ZBA. And because this is a non-conforming request to an area, they have to go before the ZBA. If the ZBA approves it and gives them basically the ability to develop this property as presented.
Why aren't we making a recommendation today? Well, why are we waiting 1 month?
But I would probably not recommend doing that only because there are some proposed improvements to the plan that should make it
better. We don't have
all
the information.
Okay.
I'd like to see the
So will we see an updated version before we make the recommendation?
Yeah.
Okay. So in that,
I think what I'd also like too is I'd like to see an estimate of the traffic. Again, Balltown Road is extremely busy, and we do need to make sure that we have sufficient water and sewer capability at the site, because that will impact, you know, the recommendation.
Well, but again, we're only at the use variance stage.
I understand. But once the use variance is granted, or if it is granted, then the town is on the hook for those utilities, right? I mean, because the buildings essentially are going to go into that area. And I'm not asking for a detailed engineer, but I think we should check that out.
Yeah, we can do that as part of the review.
Well, and in the next month...
Can the town look at that?
The capacity...
They have to as part of the site plan review.
But I think what the chairman's getting at is essentially the density would be approved at that point.
Yeah.
I mean, theoretically, if something came up during site plan that needed to reduce the density, the planning board would still have leverage, but it's difficult. It's more difficult at that point.
Difficult.
So you would,
same thing with the traffic too. I mean,
you would want
an estimate.
Yeah, if part of the use variance, the environmental impacts are, you know, looking at whether or not the density is appropriate for the area, it's probably good to check in the utilities and the traffic.
Okay.
And we would like some updates on the items we have discussed so far, the issue of forever wild pesticides, solar panels, and all that, they may be tangential to the ZBA business, but as far as a CAC recommendation goes, like that's what we would like to talk about and discuss.
And just so we know, the submittal deadline for this board's next meeting, we want to make sure we get it to you on time.
Mm-hmm.
The CAC's meeting, I think, is December 7th.
Yep. Okay.
And their packets are prepared the Friday before. So your deadline is 2023, sorry. I'm looking at 2023. I did that last night too. Yeah, so your deadline would be like December 30th or sorry, November 30th or December 1st in that area.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. We will make that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ritmo and Mr. Ritmo's attorney. I'm sorry, I forgot your name.
thank you.
Yeah, thank you for listening patiently to our.
Have a good evening. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me just get back to my agenda here. Okay, next up is EAF 2022-08, 1851 Union Street. It's the Mohawk Golf Club. The applicant is proposing 22 townhouses to be put on a parcel off Ruffner Road.
Okay, good evening, everybody. My name is Dave Kimmer from ABD Engineers. I'm here on behalf of the Mohawk Golf Club. I've also got Bill Sweet here with me. He's a project manager for the golf club. And as you mentioned, this project here is for a proposed 22-unit subdivision. The golf club is essentially looking to subdivide off approximately 14 acres of unused land here on the east side of the golf course, off Ruffner Road. So when we went about designing this subdivision, we designed it with the average density development, or what some towns call a conservation development, in mind. So what we did is we reduced lot sizes in exchange for some conservation area. Well, it turns out that you can't exactly do a full townhouse development in the town of Niskayuna, so we decided to go the route of keeping the same layout, the conservation layout, but pursuing it as a conventional subdivision with a host of area variances, because it's just necessary. I mean, the town doesn't provide for a townhome, so each lot is going to have a side setback variance. And most of the lots, while they do either meet or exceed the requirements for the conservation subdivision, they're smaller than what would be required for a conventional subdivision. So we need area variances for lot size and lot width for most of the lots as well. In fact, there's 67 area variances in total. But that's, I guess, more of a planning and zoning board concern, not a conservation concern. Because what we're actually trying to do is conserve as much land as possible. So as you can see here, the subdivision is going to be downhill from Ruffner Road. Basically, there's about 10 feet of grade change from the crest of the hill on Ruffner Road down towards the fairway on the golf course. So it's kind of a gentle slope downhill. The whole area is currently wooded. We would be bringing in traffic off of Ruffner Road from a boulevard. We're proposing a boulevard with two kind of like a hammerhead cul-de-sacs. And we're proposing to leave a 50-foot minimum wooded buffer between the rear property line of the homes on Ruffner Road and the rear property lines of the proposed townhomes. But as you can see, we're going to have a significantly more conservation area towards the ends of the development. And basically what you see here, this green area of disturbance, That's a little under 10 acres. You can see the homes here, and then down on the lower part of the subdivision, there's going to be a stormwater management area with a multi-use path that's going to allow the residents, which these townhomes are going to be marketed towards members of the golf course. It's not exclusively for members of the golf course, but a lot of the members are interested in these homes. But it is going to be open to anybody to live there, potentially people just looking to downsize or whatnot. So there will be a path where people can drive their golf carts or walk onto the golf course. This common land will be retained. The ownership will be retained by the golf course, and it'll be maintained by the golf course. So it will never be developed. And that's really about all there is to it. You know, I'm here to answer any further questions you may have.
Yeah, I have several, but you triggered a couple. So you said there's a path that, could you delineate where that path is?
So there's a, going to be kind of like a right of way almost from here, and then it'll go this way towards the golf course.
And it will provide access to the golf course?
Yes.
So is that going to be?
For members of the golf course.
Only for members. Okay. That was my question, because if you weren't a member, you would be providing access to the general public?
No.
And then the second question just popped into my mind was, you said that the land would never be developed. What land are you talking about would never be developed?
So it's maybe a little bit hard to see, but this yellow line, so this red outer line is going to be this is basically the subject parcel. And this lighter yellow line, these are going to be the actual properties. Everything outside of that is conservation area.
Oh, okay. So we're not talking about anything other than this particular parcel that
right.
you're going to subdivide. Okay. I just
right.
wanted to make sure that we were clear on that.
Yeah, except outside the yellow area to the kind of top of the page, though, is stormwater ponds that are being built.
Yep.
So really the area that's being conserved as is the 50-foot buffer between the yellow line and the red line, and then this little corner piece over here.
Right. So I just have a couple more questions. You mentioned you're basically basing this on an average density development. So specifically, how did you land on the 22 units?
Well, as part of the average density development process, you have to develop a plan for a conventional subdivision that meets all the zoning.
Yep.
So that's what we did. We said, okay, if we utilize all of this land, we could get 22 lots.
So you could get 22 lots with the stormwater management and the streets and the boulevards, and they're all conforming?
Yes. And like I kind of mentioned earlier, these lots, you know, they're not that much smaller than they could be. You know, the required size is 18,000 square feet. Most of these are over 13,000 square feet or thereabouts. Some are even bigger.
It's the footage that would get you, right? Because a lot of those lots are 60 feet,
right? The
you
width.
100.
So a lot of these lots are actually, they're about 68 feet. So again, they could be a whole lot smaller if we wanted to do a average density development, but they're kind of somewhere in between.
Yeah, and just for the record, the town of Niskayuna doesn't have currently a zoning law that would allow you to do the average density the way you have it here.
Right, yeah, that's
okay.
And that's why we're doing it as a conventional.
Okay. I have some additional questions, but why don't we open the floor to anybody else?
This is obviously a big project that's extensive in scope. You know, you were here while I was talking to the previous applicant about the need and the desire to balance where the town residents want to see the town going forward and the needs of developers. So, I mean, it's the area you're clearing is, you know, you said like 10, 15 acres, something
like
that.
It's a little under 10.
Yeah, so, you know, I grew up in India. I'm a metric guy, so I think of 1 acre as like one football field, like, you know, give or take. So we are talking like quite a big area here. And again, we are not the ZBA or the planning board or anything like that. From a purely conservation standpoint and the desire among the town residents to preserve as much green space as possible, is there scope for taking some other land that's outside of your red boundary, but that's still owned by the Mohawk Golf Club, and then saving that for conservation, like, you know, as a kind of compensation, perhaps?
Good evening, all. I'm Bill Sweet, project manager, but also a 41-year member at the Mohawk Golf Club.
Welcome, Mr. Sweet. Thank you for being here.
It's my pleasure. We've been through the process with a new maintenance building that we're building now in the interior of the golf course, and a lot of the same questions had come up. You need to understand we're a 190-acre parcel, and we participate under the Audubon Conservancy Society Golf Course Management Program. So we are already subscribing to all of the Audubon Society guidelines for golf course management, and that relates totally to tree management, vegetation management. We bring an arborist in every couple of years. Our perspective on this is not to clear-cut 10 acres. We want to go in and selectively clear what we need to clear to construct the homes, to create safe space as an offset around the foundations in the event of a tree fall, remove all of the scrub and the pine and all the things that we would remove on the golf course, which we do on an ongoing basis, and preserve all the healthy hardwoods and the deciduous trees that are going to enhance this project. So by no means are we even anticipating a clear-cut 10-acre, let's start a subdivision and then do plantings to offset what we took down. We'll work around what's there.
Yeah, be that as it may, I hope you can understand our concern too. Like, you know, even if you say you don't clear-cut 10 acres, from a town standpoint, the amount of green space that is yet undeveloped is like very, very small at this point.
Well, there'd be 4 acres of a 14-acre parcel.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
It's a 14-acre parcel outside of the red lines or inside of the red lines, and the green area represents 10.
So So
as a percentage, we're plus or minus 30% remaining green already.
So perhaps
now, golf course, if we did a calculation on 190 acres and took out the impervious area, the clubhouse, and the locker house, I would submit to you that that's all green conservancy area.
And I would accept that wholeheartedly. Perhaps forgive me for saying this, you know, sometimes your property is vast, like you said, 190 acres. And we have, informally, a lot of people have reached out to us over the years and said, like, hey, you know, the golf club is there. Like, we hear rumors in the papers that, like, some financial hardship may be going on. But I guess there is a concern among the residents that one day everything would be converted to...
I said for you as well, we've had two public meetings at the golf course by invitation to all of the neighbors on Mountain View, Linwood, and Ruffner, and we had good attendance at both.
Mm-hmm.
What we've proposed to the planning board last night is the vetting of all those comments from those neighbors. We now have a single owner who purchased the property 4 years ago now, Mike Rutherford. It's no longer a membership-owned golf course, and if you're aware of what Mr. Rutherford's done, he's already placed a pool building, put a brand new pool in, paved areas, improved the clubhouse. This is just a continuation of the investment that he's made, probably in excess of $3 to $4 million already, and this is going to be another substantial investment to continue to improve the existing asset known as the Mohawk Golf Club.
That is wonderful. So in your estimation, you are confident that the long-term financial prospects of the Mohawk Golf Club are in solid footing?
It is not a money-making proposition. Unfortunately, Mr. Rutherford's in a position that he can offset the losses that the golf club incurs. Look to the north, to our neighbor at the Edison Club. They're in the process of selling off land, an acre to Stewart, so they could build their new facility. The clubhouse was, and I'm not sure if it currently is, under contract to become a senior home. They're looking at creating a bundle community, which would mandate memberships as they develop residential around the golf course. You're seeing this more and more with private golf courses that don't have a single owner like we're fortunate enough to have at Mohawk. So we are not in any kind of financial strife or any reason to have to develop this to maintain the ongoing operations of the golf club. This is just something we'd like to do. I've got 15 people on a waiting list that are interested, a lot of them downsizing, a lot that live currently in the town at Fieldstone or at Orchard Park that would like to be here adjacent to the golf course. And that's the reason that we opted to go with 100% townhouse project rather than the average density development.
Yeah, I'd like to follow up on that a little bit. Since, again, even in the comprehensive plan, this parcel is singled out as a important parcel to the town of Niskayuna. So you are going to develop this property here. There are no other plans to develop this property in the future with housing developments at all?
On the golf course?
On the property.
This is
the
a separate parcel.
Property
this is now part of the 190 acres.
Okay.
This is a separately deeded 14-acre parcel that is coincidentally owned by Mohawk Golf Operations, LLC.
Mm-hmm. Okay, then let me...
So
let
this
me,
would be the extent of the development that could be done on this property.
I don't think I realize that. So let me rephrase the question. Are there any other parcels within the LLC that have the potential of being developed in the future?
Potentially our 9-hole par 3 golf course, which fronts on Balltown Road adjacent to the Curling Club.
Okay, and where is that in relation to this parcel here?
It'd be totally opposite the other side of the golf course.
Is. Okay.
So there's the Curling Club.
Yep.
And we're looking at some long-range plans there to improve the practice facilities and mm-hmm. the driving range, and then what do we do with the 9-hole golf course, and you know, is the use there to warrant continuing mm-hmm. to maintain that and invest what it costs to maintain a yep. golf course on an annual basis for that 9-hole par 3?
Mm-hmm.
Just full transparency to your question.
Yeah, no, I actually appreciate that. Thank you.
But the balance of the acreage is currently occupied by the 18-hole golf course, the clubhouse, the locker house, the swimming pool and cabana, the mm-hmm. tennis courts, and the parking areas.
Okay.
Given your partnership with the Audubon Society and all that, as part of this ongoing process, is the applicant open to setting aside any part of your parcel as forever wild and undisturbed?
No, because we already subscribed to the mandates of the Audubon Society to preserve certain areas for bird habitat, natural habitat, fescued areas where golfers are not allowed to walk or bring golf carts in. So we already subscribed to all that. So we
can we see a map or something like that of which areas you're already protecting?
Well, they're all internal to the golf course.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
They're all internal to the golf course.
Okay.
And I don't know that we've mapped that. I can check with our superintendent to see what he's had to submit to Audubon mm-hmm. to get that certification. But that also includes, to your point earlier, pesticide use, no toxic chemicals. All pesticides are totally governed now by the state of New York, federal mandates by EPA. And we subscribe to the Audubon Society mandates for the pesticides that you can use.
So at least in theory, the area behind the curling club could one day be converted to subdivisions as well.
It could be, because it's surplus land outside of the 18 holes and the other properties, the tennis courts and the pool and the clubhouse that I'd mentioned. And that's being considered now because we have our driving range and practice facility there, and we'd like to expand that. So some of that par 3 golf course may become additional practice area, could become additional housing. We have no plans for it at this point. That's long range, long after this is contemplated.
Chelsea, Chelsea, do you have any questions, Nikki?
I was just curious of what the cost of the townhomes are going to be.
Well, unfortunately, in my full-time day-to-day work is development and construction, and I'm not happy to tell you that the costs are not going down. The Bizalon project is, as you see, if you drive down River Road, their townhomes are starting at mid-fives, and ours, we're looking at mid-fives to six, same price point. Very difficult to build anything in a single-family realm these days for less than $650 to $700. You take a look at the sale prices that are posted. Times Union does a wonderful insert every weekend in the Times Union Sunday edition. Harmon Grove?
Grove. Mm-hmm.
$650 to $850. So we're trying to create, again, a townhouse opportunity because we haven't really had a new townhouse project in Niskayun in a long time. And there's been significant interest. And a lot of that interest comes from the neighbors in the Ruffner Road area, plus members. And we're trying to keep mm-hmm. the price. And hopefully, I'm starting to see some softening on some of the wood prices, mm-hmm. but the steel prices. And obviously, anything driven by petroleum is driving costs up. And supply chain issues are still very, very prevalent.
I'm a real estate agent, so I have a lot of people asking me about townhomes in Niskayuna. So I was curious, but it does make sense, just based on
yeah,
it
and
now.
we took a hard look. You'll appreciate this. We took a hard look at where we ought to position this from a market perspective, and understanding that there are multiple choices for single-family detached in the town, but for folks that would like to have more of a community feel in a townhome or a condominium, we don't really offer a whole lot in the town. And unfortunately, that's a gaping hole in our zoning ordinance that you can't propose without 67 variances, mm-hmm. 100% townhouse project. And we've investigated that, believe me, to the nth degree, along with Laura's cooperation and the town attorney. But we thought this was the best way to create a product that we believe would appeal to an awful lot of residents of the town and keep them here, rather than going to Southern Saratoga County or Glenville or to Loudonville or Bethlehem. And the renderings actually were provided by members of our club, the Pigliovento brothers. They're building this project down in Bethlehem across from Bethlehem High School. And they're twin homes. And they're selling right now in the mid to upper fours. And they're smaller in square footage than we're going to be proposing here in Niskayuna. And that was a project that got approved about 4 years ago. But that would be the concept, and we're looking at using a mix of materials, trying to create some diversity and elevations. One-story units, two-story units, never a one and two in the same building. It would be two ones in a building or two twos in a building, and trying to create some nice architectural appeal and the feeling of a community where you can walk up and down the cul-de-sacs and then exit out onto the golf course. The other point, and I'll bring this up, Laura, if I can, from last night,
mm-hmm.
We're also looking at some other considerations that the planning board brought up. My intent was to oversize the two-car garage so that we can include a space for a golf cart, so we can minimize Saturday and Sunday morning traffic, if you will, so members could take their golf cart and take that little pathway that Dave showed you and head over toward the clubhouse. My plan, obviously, is to put electric chargers in for vehicles and also for golf carts. Mm-hmm. Solar panels and any of the non-fossil fuel opportunities are going to be totally up to the homeowner, because this will be a fee simple ownership development, no homeowners association. This will be fee simple, owned by the townhouse owner. We obviously are going to put together a maintenance and management program that each of these homeowners can take care of, and we're prepared to maintain and take responsibility not only for stormwater, but for any of the snow plowing and the lawn care and the landscape maintenance that any of the homeowners would like on an annual basis with our golf course staff.
Okay, that was a question I had, because they are private roads, right?
So no, this will be a town road.
Oh, I thought it said private.
Mm-mm.
No? Okay, so it's a public road then?
Yes,
okay.
We're going to design and build to town specification.
Mm-hmm. I just have a couple other questions. One of the goals for an average density development is to maintain open space and accessibility to that open space. And I do notice that in your parcel, you don't really provide access to the residents in the open space to the, I guess, to the north, would that be?
This area?
Yeah, that area there. Because it looks like the The house lot takes the majority of that property there.
You're right.
Yeah, so, Dart, I'm just going to jump in there because, well, for calculating the open space preserved, like we ran into this when the Miller Brothers was doing their preservation, we don't count the stormwater areas because you essentially have to clear cut those and then build. And if you replant them, great, we'll look at the planting plan, but those aren't counted. So we just want to make sure that when you're saying the 4 acres, it's that hatched area. That's correct. Are you including the stormwater when you're saying the 4 acres?
So this, everything that's green, that's shaded here, that's just under 10 acres. So
so you're not including the stormwater? Okay. But one other thing I was thinking when we were talking about trying to maximize the open space on this parcel is, like, for instance, this parcel here, number 18, is 38,000 square feet. The minimum is 18. I know you like the square lots, but leaving the forest on the single family home parcel means...
That's what I was talking about.
Oh, okay, yeah. In the future, you know, we don't have an ability to keep it forest, but if you were to just, like, I drew it on here. If you were to pull this lot line in, you know, and make it diagonal from corner to corner, you're going to maximize that common area that's held in reserve. And you could also probably do it over here on this corner. And you're just making that extra area forever wild.
Well, I think there has to be public access to that in a way. I mean, because if you look at an average density development, one of the objectives is to preserve green space, but also make that green space accessible.
And
when I look at this, it's just not accessible there, right? Because
well, that's a condition. Excuse me, that's a condition under average density development, and we're not subscribing.
I understand what I'm talking about.
To make lands owned by Mohawk Golf Club publicly accessible is a contradiction in terms to me.
Okay, I'm looking at it from the objectives of a development. In other words,
not an average density development.
It is the spirit of why towns have average density.
But this is not going to subscribe to average density.
Okay.
Am I correct on that, Laura?
Right, Bill. But I would just say when you're like, we're trying to get close to average density, that's why we're proposing the 22 townhomes. That's why we're asking for the variance. If the town is trying to look at it in the spirit of an average density development, you know, to be flexible with the area variances, I think it's important to look at it in the spirit of the average density development with the open space. I do understand that there's an issue with the golf club owning it.
There's liability issues. The property currently, the 190 acres plus this parcel, is totally chain link fenced. And it has been
since
1922.
But I mean, I don't think that you can say we're trying to be an average density development, which is why we're, you know, 22 units, but we're not trying to be an average density development. We're talking about public space.
What you're really trying to do here, from my perspective, is you're trying to put 22 homes on a 14-acre parcel, and you want to put townhouses.
Well, I don't think we're trying to say that we are trying to be an average density development. We're trying to be somewhere in between.
No, but you said that when you first started, because I wrote that down.
Well, I guess what I was saying is that when we initially were looking at doing this as a subdivision, we did, in fact, look at it as an average density development. But after we realized we couldn't do it with full townhomes without a use variance, we said, okay, we'll do something in between.
Well, part of the exercise, quite honestly, is that you have to be able to prove that you could build 22 single families.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to go through that exercise to get to a point where we make a decision on whether we're going to go average density development, which would be the 60-40 split, or do we go to 100% townhome and request the variances that we're asking for?
Yeah, I guess from my perspective, you're asking the town to grant a variance. And what I'm looking at it is from a holistic point of view. An average density to me means preserving open space that's not fragmented, that provides opportunities for residents to utilize. And that is the definition.
How do I deal with the offset to liability to the owner of that property in the event that someone from the neighborhood is walking, it trips, falls, breaks their leg, has a heart attack, whatever?
I'm looking at it from the town interest.
Well, I understand, but this is the reality question.
Okay. Yep.
How do we deal with that liability?
A couple other comments I do have about that community is extremely isolated. So one of the objectives of the comprehensive plan is to provide conductivity between communities, and that is a completely isolated community.
Well, that was discussed last night, and the planning board felt that because they're public roadways, that the walkability would be there for those that walk up and down Ruffner Road. They can certainly walk down the boulevard and access the cul-de-sacs and walk and return back up to Ruffner.
Ellen, turn your microphone on, please. And pull it close, because you talk quietly.
Great. Nope.
Green. Oh. Hi, my name's Ellen. I was listening in the car. So I just wanted a couple of questions. So I actually live on Hawthorne Road.
Okay.
Which is the next one over. So yep. I didn't realize that there had been a public meeting, because I think I might have.
No, because we didn't extend the invitations down to Hawthorne.
Yeah.
We did both sides of Ruffner from Rosendale
yeah.
to Ruffner Court, Mountain View, and Linwood.
Yeah.
To your street.
To my street. So because my street doesn't go out, like Hawthorne is a.
It's parallel to Ruffner.
Yes. So we have to either go out Ruffner or we have to go out Rosendale or we have to go out. I'm just curious if anybody was concerned about the amount of traffic or if they had brought that up between Rosendale and that Ruffner stretch.
As part of the planning board process, we're going to end up doing some okay. type of a traffic summary.
Okay.
And part of the reason that we opted to go with townhomes rather than single family detached, number one was market, because we believe there's a real market for townhomes.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously when you think about a 4-bedroom single family and school bus trips and mom and dad chauffeuring the kids versus, you know, two folks living in a townhome or maybe three, I think the traffic impact would be much minimized with townhome development rather than a single family. But that'll certainly be something that we'll have to take into consideration during the planning board process as okay. a traffic summary, what the impact on Ruffner Road would be.
Okay, so, and that house is maybe, it's like, I know which house that is.
That's 1245 for those
yeah,
that don't
so
know.
So it's maybe one, two, so it's two houses before the stop sign, right?
Well, actually, if you come right up Mountain View.
It's.
You can see Mountain View.
Yeah, so there's two houses still when you come up Mountain View and you
go
right.
It would be to the right.
I know you go up right, but that three-way stop right there is just very busy. So I'm just
And we would end up, there would be obviously a stop sign there. One of the things we looked at was utilizing, there's a 60-foot, for those that don't know, there's a 60-foot easement that currently exists.
Yeah.
From Ruffner Road to what used to be a water tower.
Right.
The Mohawk Golf Club gave the land to the town to construct a water tower. We also had one over on our golf course adjacent to Hilltop Road. And we've come to find out that there's a 16-inch water main that the town didn't even know about. I found out as part of dropping power lines through the golf course. And there was another water tower there. Those two were abandoned and then moved over to the water tower at the reservoir years ago. Part of what we had initially looked at was trying to align Mountain View with that 60-foot right-of-way.
Yeah.
The problem is if you take a look on your way, well, you won't see it tonight, but
yeah.
The main power lines that probably go down to Godfrey and even further, but they service Hawthorne Road, come right up Mountain View, they cross Ruffner, and they go over to that area where the water tower was. Those power lines then go north and south behind all the homes on Ruffner Road
yeah.
to provide power to those homes. It would have been a monumental national grid endeavor to try to relocate those power lines to utilize that 60-foot right-of-way. We already owned the house at 1245. So our plan was to demolish that house, create a nice landscape boulevard entrance with a sign that would encourage people to, again, if it's walkable, it's going to be a public roadway. If they'd like to come down and walk and visit the neighborhood, they can. But that was the reason that we ended up having to do that offset. And the grades happened to work really well right there because we've only got about a 10-foot grade change. And as you may notice, the closer you get to Linwood, you'll see there's part of the golf course property, it's our 14th tee box, is right there. And on Saturday morning, it drives me crazy, and I committed this to all the neighbors. As part of our planning board discussion, I'd like to talk about some traffic mitigation there. I can stand on that tee on a Saturday morning and watch people blow right through that stop sign at Linwood. They don't even touch the brakes.
It happens at the other one as well. That's why I'm concerned. Like, I have a concern. A lot of people walk their dogs
lot of walking going on Ruffner Road.
A
I've been
lot.
There, I've observed, and that's something that we want to participate in from a traffic mitigation and a calming and a slowing perspective.
Yeah.
And whether that's bumps or signs or radar and better police observation, it's difficult. I mean, it's a main thoroughfare. Ruffner Road is used by a lot of folks that want to get there to Rosendale Road.
Yeah,
or going out the other way over to the river.
Yeah.
And you actually can't put a stop sign on that T, though. I mean, you could put it on the
no.
access
no,
road,
no,
but
we'll
you can't put it on Ruffner because
no.
you can't use stop
right.
signs.
We'll put a stop
control.
Coming up so that
yeah.
at least we can stop traffic coming out of the mm-hmm. project. And then, yeah.
Okay, and then I also, so I read what maybe this was already talked about. Was it all, has it been set for the emergency vehicles?
That's something we're looking at. That was conversation last night.
Okay.
We don't really have a great opportunity to come from the golf course to create emergency access. We would end up having to come down. If you're familiar with North Country Club Drive, if you look to the left, you'll see a paved access road on the golf course, and that takes us to the area in the middle of the golf course where we're doing the new maintenance building that was previously approved.
Mm-hmm.
I would have to then connect into that maintenance road, cross the 11th fairway, the 12th fairway, the 13th fairway, to get to that area that Dave pointed out that was the walking path for this project. Not really feasible. It's a long travel distance for a fire truck. It's up and down. It's not smooth topography. So one of the things that Dave and I are going to take a look at is we've got 100 feet of frontage where that house is currently located that we're going to demolish. I want to take a look at doing some kind of a stabilized, maybe mat system where grass can grow through the matting. So not only would we have a boulevard entrance, but maybe then an emergency access parallel to that as part of that frontage. It would appear to be green, but it would be stabilized. And I don't know if you're familiar with these mats. Car dealers use them all the time.
Yeah.
Where you're restricted from paving or putting gravel down on a berm somewhere, but they'll put the mats down. You can park vehicles on them. And it stabilizes the soil, but the grass still grows through and you can mow it. So it wouldn't appear to anyone as being a drivable surface except for the police and fire department that would know that it's there.
Okay.
So we're looking at alternatives to
okay.
create a second form of access.
Really a third.
Well, a third, because one of the reasons we did the boulevard was to create an alternate secondary access point, one side of the boulevard or the other. So part of the conversation last night was let's widen the boulevard.
Okay.
And then maybe add an escape route to the right of that. Not unlike what they did at Windsor with the gravel roadway
yeah.
and the bike path.
Yeah. Okay.
But all those things are being considered.
Okay.
And would that be, I mean, the town code requires a cul-de-sac can't be longer than 500 feet.
Correct.
So is that what you're proposing is the boulevard instead of?
Yeah.
So
and what we're looking at is really mm-hmm. an ingress and an egress
right.
that would give us two forms of access into the site. And then we'll propose a third. If necessary.
And how wide is that boulevard right now?
So right now it's two 20-foot lanes with, I believe, 10 feet in between. And then each of these cul-de-sacs are about 250 feet.
Oh, so that berm in the middle is 10 feet
you.
Wide?
Why don't you repeat that?
Yeah, we can hear you, but the
yeah.
recording people won't be able to hear you.
Okay. So the boulevard is, it's got two 20-foot lanes with 10 feet in between, and then off to each side, each cul-de-sac is about 250 feet long.
Okay. And how long is the boulevard there? I couldn't tell.
The boulevard, it's about 400 or 500 feet long.
Okay.
And obviously there's going to be town, utilities with a fire hydrant at each end
mm-hmm.
and in the middle of the boulevard.
I wish to come back to the question that I addressed the previous developer. Like I was saying, Niskayuna has a racial equity task force, and going forward, we would at least like to explore the possibility of having a more diverse pool of residents in the housing that is in Niskayuna. And that is something that is being talked about and as something to discuss with future developments. Is there any scope for such inviting a a diverse pool of homeowners for this project?
You'll be able to relate to this. Being a licensed New York State real estate broker, as I'm sure you are, we all have to subscribe to the Fair Housing Act. It's a federal mandate and statutes. There can be no redlining. There can be no blockbusting. You have to make a property available to anyone and everyone that would be interested in purchasing it.
I think you misunderstood my question.
We can't target. We can't try to solicit a certain buyer or profile.
I understand.
On the market and available for anyone to purchase.
I understand, but having a price point at 400K, 300K, something like that,
well,
automatically...
550 to 6.
550 to 6, automatically, not de jure, but de facto, eliminates a lot of diversity.
It certainly does, and if this was to be an affordable housing project, it would be an entirely different approach, and it would never apply to the zoning requirements of the town of Niskayuna, because affordable housing projects need federal tax credits, state incentives, and a variety of other incentives to make those rents what they are, and they wouldn't be done in a setting like this. They would be done, and I'm actually working on one at 500 Northern Boulevard in Albany, the site of the Red Carpet Hotel right now by Memorial Hospital, with a developer from Rochester. And it's a series of incentives and financings that come through the federal government and the state that buy down those rents and buy down those prices to make them affordable. This is not the type of a project or a site that would ever qualify for that type of a project. And I would just point to the north. Saratoga's been dealing with this for years. They've been building $800,000 to $2 million condos, and they don't have housing for their workers that need to work in the city. So now they're taking outlying areas around the city perimeter and looking at making those affordable housing sites so that they can apply and qualify for the types of incentives you need to bring those prices down.
I'm not necessarily talking about affordable housing and federal financial aid and things
like
that.
Even to build something at $300,000 is not feasible today based on construction costs.
I understand. Like, as I was talking to the previous developer, Mr. Retmo, I don't think his project qualified under federal aid. And
no, that's a different, that's a for rent project.
And things
not
like
a for
that.
Project, though.
You know, my bigger point is this, like, we have a certain status quo, right? This happens, that happens, everybody is playing within the rules. And yet, in a long-term perspective, such actions ultimately don't address the deeper societal issues that we deal with. I'm not saying this project should do this or that project should do that. I'm saying people come before this board and propose developments, and I always ask this question, and there are deeper issues that I feel we are not addressing at all.
What I think you're saying is it's a larger issue than this particular project.
Correct.
It should be an objective of the town to
I would totally concur with your perspective. And I, being a former town resident and having been here a long time, I see this as being not only a townwide, but potentially a countywide or geographic-wide problem. When we look at the tax base and what the costs of ownership are, how do we bring housing to an affordable point that it can be attractive to more of the masses? And that's a challenge. When you look at the taxes in the town of Niskayuna and you look at the building costs, yeah, we're segregating out an awful lot of people based on median incomes. But you know, you look at all the tables every year on what median sale prices are in Niskayuna versus median incomes and the graduation rates, and there's a reason why people are attracted to the town of Niskayuna. And a single 22-unit project isn't going to change that, but I totally concur. I think there's got to be a perspective that says we've got to be better at how we create housing opportunity for folks that need a place to live.
I want to be cognizant of the time here, so I'd like to pull
I'll get off my soapbox.
Discussion after the meeting. No, it's a good discussion to have, but I want to make sure that we cover all the bases here. The question I'm still somewhat confused about is the delineation between private and public area on this parcel. So the townhomes, the homeowner owns the property then?
It would be like any other residential subdivision, fee simple. We develop it, builder builds it, we close, they get their deed, they own the property, they own the house.
Okay, so then the Mohawk Golf Club would hold all the open space?
We'll retain ownership of these gray areas, including the 50-foot buffer.
Yep.
And the stormwater, because being only a 22-unit project, I didn't want to have to go through the aggravation of dealing with the Attorney General and doing a homeowners association for 22 units. Mm-hmm. It's a ridiculous undertaking just to maintain the stormwater area.
Yep.
So what we're doing is delineating that out. That'll become property of the Mohawk Golf Club. Under the Stormwater Pollution Prevention Program, mm-hmm. there are responsibilities for the maintenance and management of that stormwater area. Mohawk Golf Club is willing to take that on,
okay.
either in the form
of
a deed restriction
yep.
mm-hmm. or an easement,
mm-hmm.
and we will take that responsibility in perpetuity.
Okay.
And that will run with the deed to the golf club.
I see. And then the stormwater management, what is that going to be designed for? You know,
current SWIP requirements and New York State DEC.
Which is currently right now.
There's going to be a bioretention area and then a pond mm-hmm. here. So it's kind of like two separate areas.
Yep.
And then there's an outlet that goes to the golf course's existing drainage system.
Right, right. So is that a 25-year storm?
100-year.
100-year storm, okay.
I think there's going to be a fountain in there too, right?
Yeah, I'd like to aerate it. Because a lot of times if you don't move the water, you don't induce oxygen, it becomes stagnant.
Yep.
So it can become an amenity. Yeah, thank you. It can become an amenity for not only the homeowners, but for the golf course view as well.
Okay.
So I just had one question. So what about lawn mowing?
Well, part of this being that those are going to be deeded lots and fee simple, and we've got all the golf course staff and the equipment, we're already preparing maintenance programs, the concept of maintenance programs, for lawn care, landscape maintenance, and snow plowing.
Okay.
We would offer to each of those homeowners. Otherwise, they'd be on their own to do it themselves.
Okay.
And we're proposing to build and dedicate the road, build it to town spec, so the roadway would be a town road.
Okay. I was just thinking that, you know, if somebody's mowing their lawn and somebody's trying to play golf.
We get that on North Country Club Drive all the time.
Yeah.
Are you worried about hitting golf balls with your lawnmower?
No, we worry more about the homeowners, quite honestly, because some of the guys I play with that have a bad slice, you know, they're hitting it over onto the road and it's bouncing onto somebody's front lawn.
So. Yeah, no, that's what I was worried about, and someone's mowing their lawn and the golf ball goes
The
flying.
Separation between the rough and the fairway here and the stormwater area to the front yard or the backyard of those units is probably twice, if not three times, what it is now
North
from
Country.
Our 10th fairway to North Country Club.
Yeah, it's just more noise, it's just
We're used to that.
Okay. So I just have one other question, and you said you met with the Ruffner residents in the area.
Yeah, we sent out 75 invitations.
Yep.
And we had a meeting twice now in the ballroom at the golf club.
Mm-hmm. And could you just describe what that meeting was and some of the concerns?
Meeting we proposed three different concepts, which it wasn't allowed under the zoning code, but a condominium style project,
mm-hmm.
a single family detached or townhomes, and we solicited a bunch of random comments because it was the first time anyone had seen it, first time we had actually presented anything. Then that was, and I can pull my notes, but I think that might have been in May, and then we had a follow-up meeting in October, and we put a much more comprehensive list together
mm-hmm.
of the 75 in that area from Rosendale to Ruffner Court, down Mountain View and Linwood. And we had a pretty decent turnout. I would say it was probably 50. It was less than the first time. And then we set up email communication, and I haven't received a lot of emails, but I gave everyone my email address and gave them a card, and we did have some correspondence afterwards. But there were comments that they talked about in maintaining the 50-foot buffer and connectivity and how's it going to look from my backyard, and you know, so I
mm-hmm.
explained it. We talked about this a little bit last night, and I know we're all pushing against the time, a hard stop here, but the profile is going to be one that's going to have a step down kind of a look to it. And if you notice, we've kind of positioned so the units in the rear will look through the space between the units in the front line. So there'll be a gradual step down from Ruffner down to the fairway with a view shed for each of the homeowners on the backside to be able to look between the homes on the front side. We talked about single family versus townhome, school buses versus five or six residents in a house versus two. Those are the kinds of things that we discussed at all those meetings.
Mm-hmm.
And basically what we've got now is kind of all those comments and all the vetting that we did showing on this plan, where we've tried to conserve as much area around the development area as we could, and maintain the 50-foot buffer, and then try to meet the requirements of the planning board, which we're working on now.
Were there concerns with the neighbors about affecting the character of the neighborhood? I mean, Ruffner Road is a single-family. I would say it's one of the higher-end single-family areas in the town.
Anytime you offer a project up in someone's backyard, you're going to have challenges to changing the character, changing the feel, changing my neighborhood. So, yes, obviously there were concerns. When we started to explain what our development approach was going to be, I think a lot of those concerns were mitigated. Some of the things that we did offer were like the traffic calming solution that works well for everybody. There's also a downstream, if you will, hydrological stormwater issue. And it's not on our property. We participated with the town years ago and dedicated land for a large stormwater retention basin, which is at the base of the hill of our 14th tee. It's at the beginning of our 14th fairway. But there are homes beyond that, on the north side of that, on Ruffner, and I think that's Rao, that now have stormwater management issues. And they were initially contemplating that might be something we could solve. And I said, unfortunately, it's not, because you're hydrologically downgrade from where we are. If there was something that could be done.
In this development here, you're saying.
And downgrade from the retention basin that the town built on our property years ago. I said, if there were some way that you could capture that and pump it back to the retention area, that may mitigate that problem. So that came up as one of the concerns initially. They were hoping that that was going to be part of our project, that we might be able to help solve that problem. And unfortunately, there's nothing we can do about that. But other than that, it was just standard objections. How about traffic? How about quality? How about value? What's going to happen to the value of my home? And I said, well, quite honestly, just looking at market data, every townhome sale is probably going to exceed the price of resales on Ruffner Road at this point.
Was there concern about light? Like, you know, light from, I mean, I know maybe like five people that these are behind, because just because I've lived on Linwood for 22 years, or on Hawthorne for 22 years. So, you know, I don't notice any, like, you're not going to have street lights, obviously.
No street lights. And keep in mind, if as you look at that profile coming down from Ruffner, you're going to have the 50-foot buffer of trees that currently exist. So then the backyard would probably be another 50 to 75 feet before you get to a unit. So you've got a great separation there, and there will be no street lights. So it's only going to be someone's back porch light, maybe.
Yes, my children played in there for many, many years, so.
Well, and it's interesting because I look at a 1935 aerial, which we have posted at the golf club, and there were virtually no trees there at all. Because this golf course, we reformed in 1898, but down where Ellis Hospital is. And then in the late teens, GE engineers decided it was time to move, and they came up to Union Street and bought this property, and this golf course opened in 1922. So we've got a 1935 aerial that basically shows no trees anywhere. So that's why we can selectively look at where the really good hardwoods are and maintain those and deal with all the other scrub and pine and things that really don't belong there and strip those out as part of this project and ultimately maintain this like we do our golf course. And you weren't here, but we bring an arborist in every couple of years.
Yeah, I heard.
You heard that. And so we're doing selective clearing all the time and taking out the dead stuff and giving the healthy trees room to breathe and see the sun and those types of things. So. That's all part of what we're proposing here.
One other thing, I'd like to revisit the isolation of the neighborhood, because I'm not quite sure I made my point completely clear. Certainly walkability is an issue, but there's also a concern about conductivity with potentially future development. So by what I understand, and you've reinforced that the Mohawk Golf Club has no intent of developing any of the golf course areas, with perhaps the exception of the area by Balltown Road, which we talked about. But let's say down the road from now, the golf course sells. I mean, we can't predict what happens in the future, and someone comes in, puts a housing development in there. Generally, what the town likes to have is a road or access in each development segment. So ultimately, if an entire parcel becomes developed, There's connectivity between neighborhoods, because certainly a very undesirable development in this area would be having this development repeated 50 times around the perimeter of the parcel.
Yep.
So I don't know if the applicant would be willing to consider, you know, providing a stub.
We can put a couple of dotted lines on either end of the cul-de-sac. One would take you into the 14th fairway, and one would take you into the 11th fairway,
mm-hmm.
and show those as future road connections.
Okay. That
because
might
that's totally a hypothetical, that where would the roads be, where would the connections need to be, what are the stormwater requirements going to be at that time, where do utilities come from, where are the access points to service 190-acre development?
Yeah, no, actually, though, it's not a moot point, because the town has developed over a series of years, many, many years, and the stubs have played a role in interconnections between the communities. So, yes, at this point, it's a hypothetical, but it is a tool to help avoid isolated communities.
We certainly can show at the end of the cul-de-sacs some type of a connectivity that would take you out onto the golf course.
I mean, my preference would be it would be never used, but I'm being a realist here.
Yep.
You know?
I think what we could do is, you know, since we're kind of already making this provision for this, not technically a right-of-way,
yep.
but a right-of-way here,
mm-hmm.
that we could show that, since it's already kind of being set aside
mm-hmm.
as a potential connection.
Yep. That would fulfill that requirement, I think.
Well, how wide is that?
It's right now, it wouldn't be wide enough for a road.
No, it would have to meet the town standards.
But it would have to.
Yeah,
so we'll make it 60. We'll make it 60 feet and slide the houses a little bit each way and get 60-foot right away in there.
Mm-hmm.
I was involved in the Hillside Commerce Park years ago, and Kevin Walsh was on the planning board at the time. And part of the whole road configuration that now is coming through the Amador subdivision, Barbera subdivision,
mm-hmm.
through Hillside, we plotted connectivity through that project, through Hillside, down to Aqueduct. And it's just shown as a proposed dotted
yep.
line, proposed connection in the future. So I know exactly
mm-hmm.
what you're looking for. And I think we could accomplish that there on that.
Yeah. And again, it'd be my preference that never be used, but.
Yep. And ours too.
Yeah, you know, 50 years from now,
yeah.
who knows?
Yep.
Okay, are there any other questions?
So what happens next, and what do we do?
Well,
we got to go back to the planning board
yeah.
uh-huh.
first. You know, we're nowhere near approvals, so to speak.
Okay.
We have to go back to the planning board at least one more time. Then we would go to the zoning board. With assuming the planning board, you know, gives us a positive recommendation on this, we would go to the zoning board and attempt to get the table of area variances approved. And if we're successful, then we would proceed back with the planning board for, you know, final subdivision approval.
Thank you.
So I would offer a follow-up meeting if you think that's appropriate.
Yeah, I think.
No, I think it is appropriate.
Once we start to tweak, you know, the comments from the planning board, whatever the ZBA throws at us, but then we can come back and discuss it one
yeah.
more time.
Please include our comments as well, also, please.
Yeah, Laura will provide.
Yeah, just make sure you identify
yep.
those reports.
Yep.
Yeah, I just I want to reiterate again, you have this hatched area as kept being calculated in your preservation then, and a lot of this is on private property, so can you look at...
That actually, it's not in that calculation.
Oh, it's not, okay.
No.
But
no,
you
but
can increase that calculation just by reducing some of this, like,
The hatched area was just shown conceptually as to how we think the tree clearing is going to turn out.
Yeah, yeah. But what I'm saying is that, you know, there was a pretty strong resistance to setting aside any other conservation area outside of this red line. So I think trying to look at ways to increase the conservation area inside the red line is important. So if you can tighten up those lines, I would want you to look at that. And then I don't remember if we talked about this or not, but when you guys were talking about traffic mitigation, and you're looking at that summary table, Dave, can you look at the stop signs are probably not necessarily followed as well as they could be because T-intersections intersections are tough for stop signs anyway. They may not actually have been warranted when they were put there. But something that might work as a mitigation to any of your vehicle trips is like putting in one of those little mini, circles that there's not a stop sign, it's a yield, but it'll automatically make the cars. Can you just look at that when you're looking at sight lines and?
Yeah.
And actually, Laura, stop sign is New York State would have a problem if you put a stop.
No, no, not on his.
You're talking about
on
an
Mountain
island
View.
Or some traffic control. That I think is perfectly.
So his is not going to be an issue because there's not going to be the stop sign on Ruffner Road.
Yeah,
the stop sign
right,
at the end of this boulevard is completely fine. But where the traffic issue is right now, that the vehicle trips may contribute, is the intersection of Mountain View and Ruffner. So it may be worth it if you're looking at adding vehicle trips to just see if a quick mitigation would just be adding one of those little mini roundabouts to that T section.
We can definitely take a look at that. And, you know, I definitely agree that there people disregard that stop sign. I think maybe it shouldn't really be there. And I think that's kind of why a lot of people.
Yeah, the Complete Streets has just been looking at them, and they tried to do a demonstration project for this fall, but they were.
We can definitely examine that. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, it's pretty low cost, and then you change the stop signs to yield signs, and then you put the little guy right in the middle there.
All you're trying to do is create a, for lack of a better word, an obstacle where someone sees it and they're going to slow down and drive around it. And other communities do that.
He can do it. They do them in Seattle all the time. All he has to do is pull up the standard radius. I bet you it fits there. Yeah.
We'll take a look for sure.
You mentioned you've seen it. Do you have details on that?
I believe we do.
Yeah, the Complete Streets
has
details. Yeah, we do have details on that.
You can send that to Dave.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly. I mean, that would be something. And again, I would suggest if we're going to do it at Mountain View, let's do it at Linwood, too.
If that's a
so Linwood has you definitely have the space.
There you've got
you
space.
Have the space to do it at Linwood.
Yeah, because Linwood coming up is much wider than Mountain View.
Yes, much. You have the.
Now the only issue with Linwood might be line of sight.
That's what Dave.
It's line of sight. It's going to be and plowing because that.
Well, you can make them mountable curbs that don't even have green space necessarily in them. There's a bunch of different spaces.
Yeah, there's no green space, but what I'm just saying is that the way that those plow trucks plow through there, they use that to, so Hawthorne, there's not a lot of places for them to turn. Like they'll go straight down Hawthorne. Like Hawthorne, my street is like one of the last streets to get plowed. But that thoroughfare on Linwood is where they do their turning.
Well,
and stuff like
I don't think we're
do.
I don't think we're going to be doing anything over here.
But there's also other options.
But Mountain View and Ruffner, because it's so close to this intersection, it may be a good place to look at that. Linwood's a more complicated intersection.
There's also other options if that didn't work. I mean there's narrowing of the roads. There's a whole series of particular.
I think even just. You know, this is just my opinion, but people see this just, they go fast down here and they disregard this stop sign because they probably don't think anybody's going to be there. Mm-hmm. It's just a big straightaway. The sight distance is good here. But, you know, even just adding this, you know, nice boulevard, which is going to have a monument sign, just, it's something that's going to, you know, make people maybe slow down a little bit.
I heard Bill say a speed table too. I mean, maybe.
Or just
I would just look at it.
Narrowing the road a little bit.
Yeah, because
I mean,
these intersections are close together. I was looking at our code for how close you can put an intersection together, but I don't necessarily think that this street triggers our code requirements. But because you're putting more cars in an intersection, just look at the traffic calming that you could propose on Mountain View in this area.
Be happy to, because that was something we committed to the neighborhood at the meeting.
Yeah.
And again, I've seen it, you know, for I can't tell you again how many years, but on Saturday morning they blow through that stop sign at Linwood, and they barely touch the brakes.
Yeah, no, but
it's terrible. But
I would like to quickly add a strong second to Laura's first point, since. Any preservation or commitment to preservation of green space outside the red boundaries are out of the question. So within the green boundary, within the red boundary, to the extent possible, improving or increasing the conservation lands, what Laura mentioned, I would like to second that, please.
Oh,
Well, no, I think the problem is if a homeowner owns that, then they can cut the trees down. I think what Laura is suggesting is reducing that lot size, which was what I was driving at when we had that conversation earlier. And that way, basically, you take that off the table.
In total, we're already close to 30% is not being developed of the 14 acres. Add 3,000 square feet to it, and might make it 30.5%.
Oh, I'm not worried. I'm not worried about that. I'm actually worried.
Bill, it makes a difference. Can you look at it, please?
We will definitely consider.
Yeah, definitely.
I think there's a lot of good reasons to do that. And again, it's just.
But you know, whatever we might need to do to preserve the nature of the 50-foot buffer and the lands that are already shaded gray to the north side, we can do that because those lands would never be developed anyway. Yeah.
I guess the bottom line on that is by reducing that lot size, you increase the value of that open space significantly. Just that triangular area. Because it is a large percent of that triangular area.
And your partners at the Audubon Society would definitely approve.
Yeah, every square foot of forest that you can keep in the lands of the Mohawk, you know, golf club deed restricted is going to make a difference. When you're saying 3,000 square feet here or there, it's going to make a difference. So just look at it.
Yeah, we will.
That's all I have.
Yeah, so if there's no other questions, I appreciate you spending the time with us.
I think it was
a really good discussion. And we look forward to seeing your presentation.
And we'll keep you in the loop, obviously, through Laura as we move ahead.
Thank you so much for being so patient with us.
To come back and see you again.
Yeah. Depending on when you resubmit your plans, they have a December 7th meeting or a January meeting. That's just going to depend on your schedule.
Can make the next planning board meeting with our concept reviews or not?
Maybe.
Putting them on the spot. Say it again.
Maybe.
Yeah, it's okay. Like, we'll just work with your schedule. Yeah. You're not as tight as...
Off coming up.
Yeah. Because it's sketch plan right now, so when you get your sketch plan ready and it changes, you can bring it back to the CAC.
Yep. Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Really appreciate the input.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Moving on to discussion items. There is a calendar for next year. Take a look at it. We can adopt it at this meeting or we can adopt it at next meeting. If you want to look at your schedules, we can adopt it next meeting, but... Okay, we'll adopt it next meeting. Are you okay with that, Laura?
Yep, that's fine. I believe, actually, if you look, there isn't really a single anomaly except no meeting in April, which we could have a meeting if we really – oh, no, there's a November anomaly.
Yeah.
But, you know, every once in a while we don't schedule a meeting anyway because of agenda.
Yep.
The April issue is Passover and school break. So unless there was, like, something really pressing, I feel like it's okay to not have a meeting scheduled in April. But take a look and then let me know if you have any comments. Clark worked very hard on that for us.
Thank you, Clark. Okay, reports. Do we have those items in the reports?
If you guys are okay, I would skip everything because it's getting late and it's snowing, except that I did want to mention that Ellen's been poking me to make sure that I've, you know, remembered to put the wildflower seeds in our low mow area, which I appreciate very much. And I had a meeting with Nick today, ordered the seeds, got a plan. So we're going to be putting wildflower seeds around the signs that enter in and some along the fence as much as we can fit. So we ordered 5 pounds of wildflower seed and we'll probably put the seed down right after Thanksgiving break.
Good.
And it's okay. Don't panic that it's snowing. It is okay. We talked to the people. He knows. It's still an okay time to plant the wildflower seed.
Excellent. All right. Well, seeing no other items, I make a motion that we adjourn the meeting. If we hear a second.
I will second the motion to adjourn the meeting.
Okay. We're adjourned.
And thank you, Ellen, for coming in from Massachusetts. When I saw your email, I emailed back to you immediately.